So you know how Chinese is just picture writing?
There's more to this story.
Like all of the world's earliest writing systems, Chinese characters start out as symbols that stand for words. A rice paddy. A person. A tree. These are logographs, and they let you depict specific language pieces to write what you mean. But instead of requiring different characters for every word, the handy rebus principle lets you write other things that sound like the logograph to write what you say. Sure, you could use the rebus sounds like principle to write any sound in your language, but please consider this symbol and answer the question that follows. Does it mean sun, soon, sun, or sown? Oh my, did rebus writing get you into a bit of trouble here? When we see this character, we could read it as a plain old logograph, according to its meaning, or any of these rebus ways, following its pronunciation. Which one should you choose? Think a bit outside of the jade box here and take the lead of this Han scribe. His solution is elegant. Don't choose one, use both systems together. What's that behind his back? Is that a, oh yeah?
Major moments in the history of writing.
So here's the logograph for horse, but it also sounds the same as the word for ant. So the rebus principle lets us write them both with the same glyph. Confusing? Not if you add the logograph for insect next to the sound-alike character. This says it's pronounced like horse, which it is, but that its meaning has something to do with insect. You don't read the extra character, it's a meaning hint, determining how to read the sound character. So it's called a determinative. One more Mandarin example. This logograph means moon, which happens to be pronounced yue. Using rebus writing, yue also means amputate your feet. Incidentally, the word ki is pronounced the same way. Same problem. But nothing a couple determinatives can't fix. Add the determinative for metal to this character. Add knife to that one. And let's leave the moon be, because that's already what it means. Here again, the sounds-like reading of a character gives you its phonetic component. This extra logograph clues you into its meaning, its semantic component. Together, they form a unit, a whole character with a clear meaning and a clear pronunciation. Determinatives are very common in Chinese characters, natively called Han characters. In fact, since they hint at the character's root meaning, its radix, Han determinatives get called radicals. Bringing back the character's sun, it can be pronounced many ways, true. But add a determinative, a silent helper character, and you can quickly narrow down its meaning. These extra determinatives avoid ambiguous readings. Which one is the sun in the sky? Which is a father's son? Which one means soon? Too easy. There's something else to learn from this quiet scribe. He's using radicals to clean up some ambiguity, but even he knows that context matters. He won't spell everything out for you every time. Sometimes this character means for, as in, this is for you. Other times it's the verb supply. He's balancing this tension in the history of writing between what's easy on the reader, who needs more information to interpret the words, versus what's easy on the writer, who typically knows what he means when he's writing it. Plus, hand cramps. The choice of leaving in or leaving out helpful information isn't simply about clarity and laziness. It's aesthetic. Throughout the history of Chinese calligraphy, from oracle bones to the rough cursive script, stylistic choices are made, not just semantic and phonetic choices. Seeing through the calligrapher's eyes, you can find in the history of writing not only a vision of what words and sounds look like, but where words and sounds go and where they stop. When it comes to aesthetic choices and Han characters, none is more fundamental than the decision to arrange character components in blocks. Bonus note, this is definitely not the only time in history that writing gets organized in blocks. So this radical sits on top of this phonetic component in a block, making up one whole character, the character for flower. The ideograph man plus tree, a man leaning against a tree, has two components sitting side by side in a block, and they're the character for rest. And here's one tree in its own block, two trees meaning woods and three trees for forest. Aesthetics aside, what would happen if we took this sounds-like principle a step further and made writing about the sounds? Isn't that a better solution to our soon-sun, sown-sun problem? And one that doesn't make us memorize tons of characters?